Live from beautiful Baja Tustin, we have Professor Mark McNeil here to talk to us about production possibilities.
Wow, thank you, Cedric. Here we are at the International Film Studios, the McNeil International Film Studios, and what do we do here? We're doing what we always do. We shine the light of knowledge into the vast darkness of economic ignorance. That's right, celestial voices. And we empower people to live clean, dignified lives, to feed their families. So, today we're going to talk about production possibility. This is society's menu of choices. It assumes, we make assumptions before we start talking about this, that scarcity exists, that there are fixed resources, fixed technology, and there is full employment of these resources, and the rules of the game are what they are. We're going to use the production possibilities frontier to tell stories about limits. They exist because scarcity exists. Efficiency, cost, and the law of increasing costs, economic growth, and the choice between present and future consumption. We're going to use a diagram to do it. Here's the diagram. On the vertical axis, we have one good. It could be any good. We have to assume it's a two-good world because we're going to draw a two-dimensional graph. Now, in the real world, the economy produces millions of different things, but in this discussion, it only produces two, good A and good B. The horizontal axis has good A, and these are the quantities of good A and the quantities of good B. Now, there's a series of points, bumpity-bumpity-bump, and every point represents a maximum possible combination of these two goods, A and B, that the society can produce given its resources and technology. So, for instance, this point here, point T, it says the society can produce point T, and combination T, and that means it will produce this many units of good B, say 99, and if it does that, it has enough resources to produce 27 units of good A. That's a possible combination. Combination V over here is also maximum and possible, and they would produce, we'll say, 30 units of good B, but maybe 70 units of good A. That also is a maximal possible combination. We could produce only good A that many, only good B that many as well. So all points along here are both maximum and possible. What about a point inside the production possibilities frontier like point W? Is it possible to produce at point W? The answer is yeah. We could produce B1 units of B and A1 units of A. It's possible. But is it maximum? No. Can we produce more of one without decreasing either any of the other? And the answer is yeah, we could. So if it's possible to increase the production of one without decreasing the other, it demonstrates that that point is inefficient. All right, so any point inside the production possibilities frontier represents a combination that is possible, but not maximum, and therefore inefficient. What about a point outside the production possibilities frontier? Not possible, given the resources and technology. That's the first lesson about the production possibilities, that limits exist, scarcity exists. And so the production possibilities frontier at any given time shows the maximum possible. So a point inside, outside, and on the production possibilities frontier. Efficiency is on the production possibilities frontier. Now, let's show cost. Let's say we're producing beans and trees. I just had to pick two. And that this is our production possibilities frontier. It shows the maximum possible combinations. Let's say we're producing 87 beans, units of beans, and 23 units of trees. Now, what if we want to increase the production of trees to 25? That's a plus 2 increase in tree production. Can we do it without decreasing the production of beans? The answer is no. Limits exist. There are trade-offs. In order to produce more of one, if you start from an efficient point of view, efficient point here, in order to produce more of one, you have to sacrifice the other. So let's say that this decreases from 87 to 80, then that means the cost of these two additional trees is -7 units of beans. So the cost can be shown here. That's the first thing. The second thing is, you'll notice that this graph is always drawn outward bowed. It has this outward bow. It's concave with respect to the origin. And what that means is that costs increase as you produce more and more of one good. There is something called the law of increasing costs, and it says, equal added increments of one good cost progressively more of the other good. And the reason is because resources are not perfectly shiftable. That is, not homogeneous. Some resources are good at producing one thing but not another, and other resources are good at producing the other thing but not the first thing. People are that way, machines are that way. So what it means is that if we do equal added increments here, I'll do it along the horizontal axis here. One, two, three, four. So let's say we're producing 0 units of trees. That means we can produce 90 units of beans. That's our first point. But if we increase the production of trees from 0 to whatever this is, say 20, then we have to give up this many beans, that much. It's a fairly small cost. But if we increase our production of trees from 20 to, I changed the numbers here, 40, do we have to now give up more units of beans in order to produce this next batch of 20 trees? And the answer is yeah. This cost is greater than the first one. If we increase the cost again, boom, we have to give up even more. So the cost of the third batch is even greater than the cost of the second. And finally, if we increase the production, this was 40, so that's 60, and we'll make this one 80. I'm sorry that it's so messy. But if we increase this production from 60 to 80, we have to give up all of these units of beans. So with equal added increments, 20, 20, 20, and 20, of one equal added increments of one good cost progressively more of the other good because resources are not perfectly shiftable from one use to the other. I would have to say. So we can show costs here. Each time we're increasing the production of laser cutters by 3 units, the cost of the first 3 units is 2 units of Snickers bars. The next 3 cost us 5. The next 3 cost us 8. And the last 3 cost us 10 units of Snickers. So there are increasing costs. And that's because resources are not perfectly shiftable between different uses. You tend to get the most out here where each resource gets to do what it does best. So that's limits, efficiency, cost, law of increasing costs. Now, let's talk about economic growth. You'll recall that we drew this production possibilities frontier. So let's say this is 90 and that's 80 units of good B, and this is good A. We drew it with an outward bow. That's the law of increasing costs, and it assumes fixed resources, fixed technology, fixed rules of the game, and resources are fully employed. What if we get more resources? If we have more resources on the assumption that they're good for both production of A and B, if we only produce B, can we produce more than 90? Say 100. And if we only produce good A, can we produce more than 80? Yeah, say 85. And can we produce larger intermediate combinations as well? The answer is yes. So, if we get better, more resources, then we get an outward shift. Of the production possibilities frontier. What if we get better technology? Well, same thing. Technology helps us get more output with the same amount of resources. So if we get better technology, if we only produce B, we can produce more of B. If we only produce A with our given resources, but better technology, we can produce more of 80, and we can produce intermediate combinations that are larger as well. That assumes, of course, that the technology applies to both production of A and B. If the improvement in technology only helped the production of A, it would look like that. We would get more A, but the B doesn't change. So the curve, this production possibilities frontier, shifts outward if we get more resources or we get better technology. And this is what is known as economic growth. It's an outward shift. It's an outward shift to the production possibilities frontier caused by more resources, better technology, or improved rules of the game. Finally, there's a choice between present and future consumption. With a certain amount of resources, with the limited available resources that exist in the economy makes choices about what it produces. This choice exists with the economy, it exists with families, and it exists with individuals. There is a trade-off between now and later. So capital goods, for instance, and consumer goods. Capital goods are goods you sacrifice now. You live less well now in order to accumulate the capital, but then the capital, once it's produced, can make you more productive into the future. Going to college is an accumulation of human capital. It makes you more productive, you live less well now, but in the future your stream of income should be higher. Unless, of course, you're a medieval lit or linguistics major. Wait, did I say that? Well, we can cut that out, okay? Anyway. So, if for instance, here's the production possibilities frontier, you can pick any of these combinations. This one has lots of consumer goods and not much in the way of capital goods. But lots of consumer goods. That means everybody's living well now, but they're doing